Yeah, hi everyone. My name is Mataprasad, Agrawal. I work as part of Persistent Systems. I'm as a senior architect in the analytics practice. So today I'm going to cover a very interesting case study on a data lake and how streaming applications or streaming technologies can be used to solve some very cool data science related problems. So this was for one of the very interesting customer in oil and gas industry. So typically these companies, what they do is, let's say you are in the Middle East and you have lots of wells and you have a lot of heavy machining infrastructure, and they dig the oils in certain regions. So they have a lot of manufacturing processes which actually generate lots of data in real time. And this data is generated is very, very humongous in nature. So this particular customer came to us, you know, they wanted to, you know, digitize all of their manufacturing processes and, you know, apply streaming technologies to analyze this and predict the noise. So the noise was, you know, you are drilling some wells and the machine is hitting into some sort of a failure and it is, you know, it is not at all functioning. Then you need to actually capture those events as a noise, or whether it's a normal event, your well is functioning fine or no. So this is what they wanted, to have robust data ingestion where there are real-time parallel streams coming from hundreds of wells and the regions, and you know, predict whether it is good data or the bad data. Okay, and the stack we used was, you know, Kafka was the source, and the Spark streaming, we also plan to use Apache Apex streams for that. And we use Spark ML for for using the data science and using some of the Python tools like Scikit and Pandas. Okay. So they wanted to build a full data lake, but the intent was a big data scientific analysis and the visualization of the real-time data. So this was a typical architecture that we had given. So these were their application. This was the sources. One of them was a streaming applications which was generating data, these machines. And there was a Hadoop raw data storage and a lot of computations were happening. Okay. So this was the POC where we did it in the month of January, and this was the outcome of that POC. So they gave us around 960 million records, which is around 1 billion records, okay, in real time. And we could achieve very high throughput, around 35,000 ops per second on a 6-node cluster. And we could pre-process that data in less than 2 hours, because, you know, if you want to create any machining or machine learning model, you need to pre-process the data. Okay. And we could build the visualization on the raw or the processed data. And we could provide the access to that with very fast query visualizations. And the accuracy of the models was around 80 to 90%. Okay, so this was the data. And before you delve into any machine or data science related project, you need to understand the data very well. Okay, so the input data was something of this sort in Hadoop. So there was a peritids, which is a well, and underscore one is for some sort of, this is a region and there's a well one, and there's a data given for around 2 months. So each day there was a file given, and there were 86400 records per file. And if you look at, you know, one well might be having into different, going into a different machining process. So it used to spit out different variables for each second. Okay. So you may have, let's say, 10 wells. One is giving you 2 variables. Another well is giving you 25 variables. Okay. It's a hard problem, you know, because you have varying schema coming into the picture. So this was a synthetic data they gave to us. But it was very close to their actual data. But if you look at this, so every well, every day, there is a different number of variables coming, and it's very hard to create a model out of it. So what we did, we had to transform this in real time. So what we did is, you know, given region, well, and day time, we could come up with the rows. So if you look at this particular time, there are 2 variables. So we could actually convert these columns into the rows. Okay. So now if you get 25 variables, 50 variables, you don't care about it. Okay. So I'm able to represent my columns as row values. Okay. It's a generalized data structure now. Okay. And given this as an output, then I could visualize using Hive or any of the querying engines. I can run some aggregations within the streaming pipelines and generate some data. Okay, for this region, this well, on this particular day, this is the how this particular variable is behaving. Okay, now that variable could be, you know, some temperature, pressure, whatnot. Okay. So the problem statement was to build an event detection using binary classification. And so we built an analytical model on historical data. We validated it and proved that the accuracy is really good. They also wanted us to save the model in a reusable format in HDFS. So we use IPython's Pickle library and load that model and predict the real-time events as the new fresh data is coming in. Okay. So the data was around 10 regions, 197 wells. There were lots of directories in Hadoop. It was a time series essentially data. It was not a textual data. Most of the good part was most of them was in numeric fields, not categorical fields. And they had given some labeling for the existing classes. So they gave us some wells where they say that there is a this particular in this particular day there is some noise happening on this well. Okay, but where in that particular hour or the minute they didn't tell us. Okay. And they wanted us to predict the noise for this. So what we did, once we understood the data, it is very easy to plot it and see what it is doing. So we plotted this. So there were a bunch of these filters, regions, well, and different types of variables. So we selected all the variables across all the days. Okay, and we plotted it on a time scale, which is x-axis, and different values. So we plotted min, max, average, distinct counts of all those variables. And we could see some patterns. I mean, if you see the center part of this graph and at the end, there is something weird happening. You know? Usually there is some pattern, but you know, that is what, it doesn't tell me anything beyond this. Okay. Now then we did another plot in terms of the bubble. So if you look at, there are some variables which are 110,000, some variables are very low, 80,000. So most of the bubbles are into, you know, 100,000s kind of a value. This was a distinct count. Then we did a delta of min and max minus min of each of the variables. So you see most of the variables are around 0.48, 0.16, but there is one variable 15, which is kind of 0.16, so which is an interesting variable for me. Okay. So I analyzed my data. I analyzed some of my data through visualization, but I'm still not to the point where I can predict the noise. Okay. So we selected some features, so it's obvious, and as the variable is moving, you can see min, max, and the average value. It was not giving us any good outcomes. We again plotted max, min, average on these variables. So we could see, you know, on a normal day, so they had given a problematic day, abnormal day, as well as a normal day. We could see, you know, there are some spikes, but they did not tell me anything, because on an abnormal day also, I could see the same spikes. Okay, nothing much I couldn't derive from this data. We plotted this data in a library called as Veka, and if you look at, so this is again, the red one is an abnormal and the blue one is a normal day. And we could see, okay, for generally, you know, layman's term, there is a two steps you can see, right? So there is a pattern, but in some of the variables like this one, okay, there is a different pattern I can see, there is a different pattern on these variables. Those variables are interesting for me. So in the second plot, I could see that some variables are interesting for me. In this also, I could see some variables. Then we did it for same thing for minimum. Okay, most of them are similar, but some variables are showing different pattern. Okay, same for average, max, min, and the distinct count. This is where actually we could see, okay, there is a completely different pattern on an abnormal day versus a normal day. Okay, and we could see some more things. So why I'm showing all these variables, you know, because they are very useful for my feature selection. And there were lots of libraries available, R, Veka, you might be aware of some of these libraries or have already used it. We use scikit and spark mllib. And since it was a classification problem, we use some of the decision trees to predict the classes. Okay. So this picture you might have seen. So generally, if any machine learning problem is given, you first try to classify the problem itself, whether it's a regression or a dimensional reduction problem or clustering or classification problem. Okay, so we use scikit-learn. So as you know, Python scikit integrates very well with Spark and other libraries, and in a notebook environment, you can quickly play with your data and visualize it using different visualization tools. Okay, we found that in some of these, like, you know, these machining things, so at some time they are hitting into some, let's say, rock, and they may not generate some data. Okay, so there were lots of missing values. So we wanted to impute those missing values. We had done some sort of a normalization to bring the variables on a similar scale. Okay, so Spark MLlib was used along with Spark Streaming for detecting some of the patterns and classification. So what we did was, we first of all did a data processing. We collected all of this data. From the plots, we could see some of the features. So we picked up those features like delta, min, max, and the distinct. We built this model, and we tested with the model of 60% of the data, and we saw the accuracy. It was good. So we went ahead with that using the real-time prediction. And we used two wells for the real-time prediction. Okay, so this was what the pipeline was. There were raw files which were continuously getting returned to the Hadoop directory. We copied those files to some predefined locations. Spark picked it up and we pre-processed it, and it was fed to the Spark ML lib job, which saved the model. Okay, so my model is saved now. This model was saved as a pickle file. Okay, this we talked about. Then once my model is created, I use that model for real-time prediction for the fresh data. Okay, and in the classification, there are lots of algorithms. So we picked up these four and we tried to plot the ROC, receiving operator characteristic, and the precision recall matrices and see which one is good. So decision tree and gradient boosted tree gave us good accuracy around 88 to 89%. Okay. So if you look at, you know, the streaming is becoming very, very common, and all of this we could do. So the data pre-processing, 96 GB data, around 2 hours. Then time to build the model was 12 hours and 52 minutes if we reduce the number of features. As if you increase the number of features, the model time will go up. Model time, building time was very tiny, and the event prediction was 3 to 4 minutes. So what it means is, given an event, I could predict the noise or the wrong classes, abnormal events within 3 to 4 minutes. Okay, these were some of the confusion matrices results. So if you can see, you know, there's around 88-90% accuracy. The true negatives we could predict very well, as well as true positives. And we tried with multiple tools. Weka was used for as an exploratory workbench. We used scikit. So scikit and Spark ML give us very good accuracy. Okay, any questions?